keep it here. We were talking about making a film on the film. Be good, that. You know, just like you were part of it, viewers. You know, you're here with us. What do you think we should do? Hell, how do you make a movie, man?
Thank you very much, good evening, ladies and gentlemen of Great Britain. Bonsoir Paris. Guten Abend München. Hola España. Ciao Roma.
Good evening, New York.
Litua Tokyo.
Chez du Brazil.
People of Canada.
Hello, Netherlands.
When I was 40, everyone said life begins at 40, so I looked around for a couple of days and nothing appeared to begin. So I thought, oh, well, I'd better start some stuff. So I started, like, jogging a little bit, you know, because I'd never done that before. But that might be a good idea, and that was good fun. I enjoyed that. Nothing serious, but a little bit. And then I thought, well, I'd love to paint. You know, I've always loved drawing. And at school, I did get a little art prize, but they were never anything big. But I did love to do it. Always loved to doodle and fiddle around. But I always had this big block in my head that it was those people that painted and not us. It's like they ride horses, we don't.
I tell you, actually, the most fun about this for me was playing with the charcoal. I'd draw the charcoal away from the line, see? And you get that, and try and leave the line. So it still was a...
So you got both?
You still pull it away here.
Yeah.
So this is all just playing with this little... theory I started getting. And you see this kind of bird on the top?
Oh, yeah.
Like a little hawk screaming in the sky.
Yeah, screaming, yeah.
Oh, this is a representation of a tree.
Yeah.
There's another little one there. But then this owl on an oar.
It's an owl, isn't it?
It's a golden oar.
Yeah.
Like, he's sort of...
like my end
oar.
Yeah.
And then this little guy, so it almost reminds me of a cross between a bishop and a punk. So they're almost like, his robes are almost, you know, religious, regal robes somehow. Yeah. But then he's, and he looks a bit bishopry. But then, got this slightly wild hairdo.
Some days I look at you with eyes that shine. Some days I don't believe that you are mine.
It gives me a very similar thing to what music does. It's sort of, it's a consolation. And I just love it. I just love to do it.
Some days I look. Some days I look into your soul. Sometimes I laugh to think how young we were. Sometimes it's hard to know which way to turn.
She's like John in that kind of way, you know, she's like, go on, do it, go on, you know, try it, have a go. She's been strength for a long time, you know. We're married, what now, 20, coming up for 28 years, you know, so, yeah, she's my baby. She comes out at night, taking me by surprise. Yeah, she's my girl.
We don't need anybody else to tell us what is real inside. Each one of us is love, and we know
wild pigs in these woods. And some people accuse us of harbouring killer pigs. Just that we don't shoot them anyway. But you'll see their tracks.
Quite harmless, really, but we've never seen them.
You know, we know everything's bigger in America, like England's a little bit smaller, perhaps, but that is our giant redwood. give him time. Give him time. That is a Sequoia giganticum. Come back here in 200 years, and should be right shooting up by then.
I like the idea of just this sort of, you know, out of left field, flame pie. It's just different. It's and it's got the Beatle connection. And, you know, I'm not ashamed to admit this album's come off the back of the anthology, as I say. Yeah. So any of those connections, I'm quite comfortable with.
The title, Flaming Pie, is based on a story. John actually wrote a little article in the local paper called Merseybeat, where he said... When I was 12, I had a vision, and a man came unto me on a flaming pie, and he said, "You shall be the Beatles," with an A. But when we came in the anthology to answering the question of who thought of the name the Beatles, me and George said, well, it was John and Stu. So we had to fudge the issue a little bit, just for the sake of compromise. But so Flaming Pie became a little bit of a joke for us, you know, that anyone could take it seriously. So I made up a song on this new album, and then it's the title song on it, and it's... It's a little bit of parody on the whole idea of a flaming pie.
First met Linda and I, she said, "I didn't know you played like heavy guitar like this," because I'd have an amp and an electric guitar at home around about the time when I was doing McCartney. I'd be sitting around just doing this kind of funky stuff. She said, I didn't have you figured for that. You know, she didn't know me that well personally. And then I could see the world tonight. You know, a few people I think like it's a little bit rockier,
yeah,
a little bit tougher, the backing and stuff, you know, which is nice. Got that little guitar riff. It's good fun doing that.
I saw you sitting at the center of a circle. Everybody wanted something from you. I saw you sitting there. I saw you swaying to the rhythm of the music. Got you playing. Got your brain to the voice inside you. Saw you swaying there. I don't care what you wanna be. I go back so far, I'm in front of me. It doesn't matter what they say. They're giving the game away. Hey, hey. Secret conversation. You were crying. You were trying not to let them hear you. I heard you listening in. Never mind what they want to do. You got a right to your point of view. It doesn't matter what they say. They're giving
tonight. I thought it would be better, rather than making big million-dollar videos, just to use almost home movie footage or documentary footage to illustrate the songs. Sunday was the most recent of all the songs on the album. It was just written shortly before we were finishing it all. It was on holiday. And when I go on holiday, I like to sail. And not a big boat, just a little American Sunfish called. And they're just, it's a single person. It's just me, the sail, and the wind. Repeat the chords that you've got going for the song and then do a solo over those chords. And then I thought it'd be a nice idea to play with my son James, because he's getting really good on guitar. For me, I mean, I was very proud. I mean, that's the thing, you know, just as a dad, it's just brilliant to be playing with your kid.
It's peaceful, like heaven on a Sunday. Wishful, not thinking what to do. It's a dream.
we're going through. And if I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose.
That's it. We don't need no more.
That sounded good.
All right, Jeff?
Good. Great.
Rocking.
Lost Beatles film. But it's us doing a little photo session. And then took some stuff. Nobody ever knew this existed. So this is really cool. That's quite nice. Standing against John's big, I think it was John's big white roller. And that was before he had it done. Say they suddenly said they found this roll. I said, wait a minute, what's this? We haven't got this logged anywhere. Well, it says Beatles on it or something, you know. So then said, right, develop it up, let's see what we've got.
I was on holiday, I got a phone call from a friend telling us that a very close friend of our family, who we'd known for a long time, had died. And so it was a real shock to me and Lynn and the kids, and obviously that day we were very saddened by the news.
So that afternoon, as my wont, I was going to go write a song, so I couldn't think of anything else really. And I just thought, well, it would be nice to do a song with this mood, convey this mood, but also for the kids, so that I could kind of somehow convey how much I thought of you. So that was it, and I came up with Little Willow.
Bend, little willow, wind's gonna blow you hot and cold tonight. Life as it happens, nobody warns you, willow, hold on tight. Nothing's gonna shake your love, take your love away. No one's out to break your heart, it only seems that way. Hey, sleep, little willow, peace gonna follow, time will heal your wounds. Grow to the heavens now and forever, always came too soon. Nothing's gonna shake your love, take your love away. No one's out to break your heart, it only seems that way. Hey, bend, little willow, wind's gonna blow you hard and cold tonight. Life as it happens, nobody warns you, willow, hold on tight.
for the next episode of Ubu Jubu on the next single.
Ubu Jubu is what I say. A little bit of Ubu Jubu in the night, in the daytime, never did anyone any harm. Listen, would you like to come around my studio? This is a Wings Mellotron. And these were the original synthesizers. I must say, when we first saw them come in, we never thought we'd get them past the Musicians Union. We thought somebody would be ringing up saying, oh, that's taking musicians' jobs. Because it was, you know, like synthesizers have since. But EMI had one, and we used to record there. So, again, you know, it was available to us. So probably the most famous thing we ever did on it, one of the first uses we ever put, was flutes on the front of Strawberry Fields. And I played a little sort of thing on the front of John's song there that really gave it like a distinctive character. I think I've still got the flutes up on here. So this is something I did for the anthology folks, you know, when they came around. But this is like, I think this is the original flutes, something like this. Take you down, and then you go, whoa, you do something like I've done a lot of the drumming on the new album, as I say, because having drummed for, this will be loud, watch out, so having drummed for years since the old Lord Woodbine days, and sometimes I'd stand in like in Hamburg for Tony Sheridan, didn't have a drummer, and I'd just have to play it. Anything I really can't do is shuffles. They're difficult to do, that's just the coordination I can't. But I can do more if it's just a straight sort of rock and... Oh, I love you. Mm-hmm. Like a bird needs a break. A bird needs a break? What are you talking about? And your mind is racing, you know. I want your heart, baby. Yeah. Dropping on a plate. This is my very first amp I ever had, actually. When I was 14, I had this lamp called an El Pico, and it's, as you can see, it's very 50s. It's the design, you know, is all, this is all very, looks like a piece of 50s furniture, you know. But here it's got, instead of putting, you know, instead of putting guitars into it, it says mic one, mic two, gramophone, anything but guitars, really. And for instance, in, I think it's Penny Lane, we said the fireman rushes in. And we just use that just for him rushing in, you know. Or at the other end of the mallet, this is three bars of office lighting, basically, only coloured pink. But there they go, as you can hear me switching them on. And they've appeared in glorious Technicolor. And this was it. This was EMI's nod to psychedelic lighting. Elvis will have been standing just about there somewhere. Bill Black backing him up. Well, since my baby left me, I find a place to dwell. It's down at the end of Lonely Street. It's a big hotel. It's a lonely baby. You'll be so lonely. You'll be so lonely. Goodbye. So that, for me, is a very special piece of wood. It's the Elvis Presley bass. You know, round about those days, it's also sort of a little bit sleazy, a little bit cabaret, but you get stuff like this. I love the sound. Ooh, come on, baby. Can I buy you a drink?
Oh, all right. Where are you from then?
I'm with the government.
All right. I'll have a gin in it.
Well, come on, baby. My little darling. Want to drink with me? Come on, honey, maybe we'll go back to my flat, my flat.
I'll go on and twist my arm. Yeah!
It's back, yeah. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. You see, you can have acres of fun on these things. Oh, boy, I tell you, if you see what I mean about the sleaziness of it all, I love it. Oh, France! Welcome to the castle. Quite a windy night out here. But you know, I always love it here in Hirschwig von Schlechtheim.
Who's this Hans character? I've never heard of him.
Don't worry, my darling. We're all together.
Woo! You can have a lot of fun on these things, oh, I'll tell you. Not just me, a lot of young people, too, are looking for this equipment now. I mean, I know Lenny Craddock. He uses it.
Kravitz!
I knew I got that wrong. Lenny Craddock.
Oh, never mind.
He calls me Paul McCarthy.
Oh, I wish there was some people out here to keep me company. It's so hard in the woods on your own. Still, never mind.
At the moment, I'm working on a new project with Jeff Dunbar, who also did the animation for Rupert. I do most of the voices myself. We can't afford any big-time names. It's called Tropic Island Hum. And the nice thing about it is that we're doing it in the old style of cartoon making, frame by frame, instead of on a computer.
Cheers, Sam. See you very soon. Yeah, I never... It's your musical kind of thing.
Welcome to our island. Glad you came to call. Now you've made yourself at home. You're welcome to us all.
We are simple people. Why are we this way? This is why we...
Lovely. So you're going to stick that on a tape?
Yeah.
And then I can take that away and me and Link can have a look at it. Yeah. Before you go to full colour, yeah?
Absolutely, yeah. Because we've got to,
Gear the move
all the drawings. Well, they're upstairs still doing the mask, which is...
Shall we go and have a look?
Yeah, see, that's a duff one. Now that's corrected there. That's beautiful. Yeah.
Ooh,
just
lovely,
easing
yeah.
along there.
Yeah,
see,
giraffe, real giraffe look there, yeah.
Why are we this way? This is what we always say. It's the way that we bungle the bungle. It's the way that we bang the big bass drum. The way that we sing the song. The bass drop beat island hum.
Yeah, it's a big improvement on this sequence, isn't it? Because we were always, that was one of the big problems with your headache. I think that trick of yours, the decision to pull it down to three.
Yes.
Because we had, what, about 10 of them leaping around, didn't we? None of them had any personality at all.
Yeah. So it's kind of a process of finding your mistakes, you know, each time, and then correcting it, finding it again, correcting it.
And you just kind of overlay those on the old drawings, do you?
In most cases, we're doing it again.
Yeah.
Now, you see, the bags are really look terrible there. So what we're doing is dovetailing them in, putting more shadow on them, just gently easing it in.
I think, you know, we did think at one point that was a little too tough, that line, you imagine someone wanted to kill that lovely creature and eat it. I don't think it is too tough. I think for this island, I think... You know, I sort of quite like the way we're being a little bit uncompromising.
Can you imagine someone wanted to kill that lovely creature and eat it? All right, Frogo. All right, Wirral. I know what you mean.
All right, don't come and see us, Ashton. Are you coming?
No, you don't have to.
I'm seeing Ashton.
You don't have to. We'll see you. That was lovely, thanks.
Okay, bye.
Bye-bye. It's the way that the bag of the mongo.
Yeah. The other thing is I've got a load of requests here, interview requests from like all around the world. I mean like the Times, the New York Times, the Q, Brazil, like
France, Italy, Spain,
Congo Basin, I mean you name it, and they want you.
I'd like it just sort of
maybe in each country kind of thing, you know. That'd be nice for me. So, you know, you always go that way with everyone wants every single cover of every single magazine. You get yourself in these terrible political things of so-and-so won't give you the cover unless they
see you on the bog.
Yeah. Or whatever, you know. So, I think just let's play it real nice and easy, nice and gentle. Don't sweat it, you know, as we've said all along on this album.
No sweat, man.
Yeah, the other thing, Paul, the last thing was like the launch of the documentary.
Looking at that as that to be the launch of the album.
Rather than doing a separate thing. I don't know where you fancy on that or whatever, but somebody was saying, maybe that should be in New York.
Yeah, it wasn't me. That wasn't me, mate.
Yeah, better here.
Yeah, I think, I was thinking...
Of it being a quite simple affair, really, instead of some hugely complex thing that gives us all bad dreams at night. Let us have a laugh, and let us not sweat, and let us put an album out. End of story. All right, Jeffrey. I'll see you around. Thanks a lot.
He's just a young boy looking for a way to find love.
Young Boy in America, that's the only track that's, I think, that's recorded out of the studio. So I called up a couple of mates. First of all, called up Steve Miller. And I say, Steve's great to work with, and I knew he was very comfortable to work with, and we admire each other. Always a big help. I love his guitar playing, you know.
Kids and me and John were wandering around with guitars slung over our shoulders. If you just ever said that, like, it'd be a National Trust house, I mean, the idea is still fairly laughable, I tell you, because it's a little terraced house, you know. In that area, John and I showed my dad the final version of She Loves You. So this had a lot of memories. I wrote, like, When I'm 64, the tune to that when I was 15 or 16 or something.
I was asked by the Liverpool Orchestra to help them celebrate their 150th anniversary. They asked me to do something, so I did the Liverpool Oratorio for that, which was quite a departure, you know, a big stretch. I enjoyed that so much that after it, I thought, well, I could now just write another, but I thought, no, I'll wait for a commission. It's so much better if someone says, hey, would you do so-and-so for us? Because then you almost don't feel to blame them. So I was like, well, he asked me, you know, what can I do, you know? I'd just written this probably hour-long thing for the London Symphony Orchestra. It's called Standing Stone. That's been on this. And, you know, it's for a big choir as well, so you can see how the choir's going to sound.
Chappies, more big chappies,
little lassies.
Oh, this is a good question. This is from James Gregory in New Orleans, Louisiana.
Yep.
What is your favorite song you have written since leaving the Beatles and Wings?
It's always difficult, you know, to have a favorite, because... but maybe I'm amazed. Let me just make a short answer. Yeah, maybe I'm amazed. Maybe, you know.
What about since?
I like that one.
Well, I'm Greg from London. Great trainers, by the way.
Hi, Greg. Thank you.
I just wanted to ask you, of the kind of newest generation of artists and musicians, who inspires you creatively in 1997?
Most of the newer artists I know through my kids, not through me buying them, just through hearing them play them, you know. So I like Beck. I like some of his stuff, you know. There's a band called Paw, who, like, I think they're a snowboarding band that I've heard a little bit of. I like Oasis, you know. I mean, it's always a loaded question, that, you know, but about Oasis. But I do like them. I think they sing good. I think they play well. And, you know, if they're going to be derivative, then it might as well be something I'm connected with. You know, it's a tribute.
Okay, let's go to another question from a man in the street.
Hi, Paul. I wanted to ask you what your favorite song that you ever wrote was, both solo and for the Beatles.
Well, that was a great guy on the street.
Yeah, boy. Well, you know, Paul, every fan has their own opinion on what's the best Beatles song, and they all say, oh, this one's the best, this one's the best, I like this one the best. We found an American Paul McCartney fan who really wanted to be on the show and talk about his opinions. Can we roll the tape of that guy, please?
I just thought they were full of energy, but they were also brilliant. I mean, you go back and listen to Sgt. Pepper's album today. They were brilliant. I still think Eleanor Rigby is one of the most powerful songs I ever heard. I mean, they were just brilliant. Woo!
My man.
You've got a lot of busy kids, actually.
Yeah, I got four kids. James is still in college, and he's looking maybe to do music. He's, you know, he would like to get into music. My daughter, Heather, is a potter. She just had a big exhibition in New York and in London.
The youngest cast member of Let It Be.
Yeah, that's Heather. Right. Yeah, that was her. Yeah.
Those who saw the movie.
Little baby she was then. And then my daughter, Stella, has just got a big job with Chloe in Paris. She's head of the fashion group there. So she's the head designer. She's doing great, working hard. You know, she's got a lot to do there. And my other daughter, Mary, is into photography like her mum. And she also is into films, and mainly photography, but a little bit of film. In fact, she and her boyfriend, Alistair, put together a video.
Did they?
So, yeah. Act surprised, John, act surprised. It's...
Really?
Yeah.
Who knew?
Yeah, well, you know what? He directed it, she produced it, and I believe it might just be coming up.
I saw you sitting at the center of a circle. Everybody wanted something from you. I saw you sitting there. I saw you swaying to the rhythm of the music. Got you playing. Got you praying to the voice inside you. I saw you swaying there. I don't care what you wanna be. I go back so far, I'm in front of me. It doesn't matter what they say. They're giving the game away. Hey, hey! I can see the world tonight. Look into the future. See it in a different light. I can see the world. Secret conversation. You were crying. You were trying not to let them hear you. I heard you listening.
I'm Susan from New York City.
Hi, Susan from New York City.
And one of the
reasons... Paul from Liverpool.
Really? There was one thing that you could change about our world today. What would it be?
Violence. Get rid of all the violence and everyone go veggie and be into animal rights and we'll just be okay.
And Paul, I believe this, set it straight, is this the Bishop's Gate, as mentioned in Being for the Benefit of Mr. Kite?
Yeah, it is, yeah. It's presumably the poster that was taken off, you know, Pablo Fanke's Fur, was somewhere around here.
The celebrated Mr. K performs his feat on Saturday at Bishop's Gate.
At Bishop's Gate, on Saturday, too. What a coincidence!
Is that why you wanted the venue?
Yeah, that's... I actually happened to be visiting a choir that was rehearsing here for something else I'm doing. And the VH1 people were looking around for a town hall. I said, well, I know one. And it's in Bishopsgate. So, in fact, I'll tell you what, have you got a minute for a mad idea?
You know what, Paul?
Are you ready for a mad idea?
I'm glad you brought that up.
Live. Hey, John. Here you go, here's where we drive the sound men mad. You've got to sing a bit, okay, audience?
Yeah.
I was sitting in my dressing room just before, and I thought, well, I'd be mad if I could come up with some little song about Bishopsgate, all right? And now it would be really mad if I can remember it. Yeah. But where your bit is, sound man, all you've got to do is... You've got to do... That's it. So remember, that's your bit. Okay. I'll try and remember the song now. Yeah, okay. Oh, now, baby, now the Bishop's Gate ain't what it used to be. He came over from America and he put it on the TV. Well, now they say that they're coming back and I can hardly wait. All over the place, you know. So I thought, right, well, that's all right for one.